Thank you. So welcome for the for coming for this talk. So it's a joint work with some Belgian colleagues from Mons, so Thomas Brier, Marion Allais, and Bruno Quatin, and Gilles Guerrers, that is from Brussels. And I will be working also on games, but quite different games. And in particular, my main application will be networking, so routing perspectives. So I'm not at all someone from network theory, rather from formal methods and game theory, but we'll see that it's very natural, and we will maybe be able to use our techniques, like simulation-based techniques, in order to solve these natural problems in network theory. So first, let me just briefly mention what is the game theory problems, what are the game theory problems. And so you all know the rock, scissors, paper game. And one way to model that game is to use some kind of matrices where you have the payoffs of each of the players. So if one player plays paper and the other one plays scissors, then you go there and you know that the first player loses and the other one wins. So you have a way to model that as a matrix game. And somehow in game theory, in classical game theory, you have three assumptions on the players. The one that is, so players are clever, so they are able to reason perfectly. They are rational, they want to maximize their payoff, so they want to win. And they are selfish, they don't care about what other people will win, with whether they will win or not. They just want to win themselves. And in the static approach, and this is somehow what also Tim Rogarden spoke about in the tutorial, they really care about notions of equilibrium somehow. So it's a static approach. You just want to find something that is a nice equilibrium, or you want to study the price of anarchy or something like that, which is completely static. You fix this equilibrium once and for all. All players do that and you are fine. So somehow another way to think about game theory is a more dynamic approach. So in particular, what do you do when you don't really know what other players will do and you have no way to communicate with each other? And so you still have to find some good strategy. So a priori, the first time you play the game, you will not find immediately a good strategy because you have to learn a little bit of information about what other players want to do. So it's concretely impossible to find immediately a good strategy, but if you play several times, you can learn things. So you can learn a little bit of information, and you then improve your strategy again and again when you continue playing the game. So the question is this dynamics gonna stabilize or not? So is it possible that if you have enough plays, at some point, you find some good thing, some good profile of strategies? And if yes, is it the case that the strategy that you obtain after convergence is a good strategy or not? So that's the question. And indeed, it's an idea that is used in several places, like in the learning, machine learning part of game theory. So where indeed the machine is playing against itself somehow, and it learns from the mistakes by some kind of payoff way of thinking. And so so this is really the things that they use in order to learn the games. But also, if you think about strategy improvement algorithms in order to solve something like parity games, for instance, it's also some kind of dynamics. You will replay the game again and again until you find something that is a good strategy. And it is also the main purpose of evolutionary game theory, where now somehow the game works in continuous time, so it's more with differential equations, but it's again the same kind of things. So now there is a link. I mean, this is the main purpose of the thing. So there is a link between the static approach and the dynamic approach, which is that if you are looking for an equilibrium, like a Nash equilibrium, for instance, then this is the same as looking for some kind of stable points with respect to the dynamics. At some point, you will converge towards some profile of strategies where you do not change your mind anymore, and this is some kind of equilibrium. So here is the example of the rock, paper, scissor game, where somehow, wherever you start with, at some point, if you follow these curves, you will converge towards the single Nash equilibrium, which is playing one third, and probability one third for each of the three possibilities. Okay, so now what I want to do in this talk is to apply this kind of ideas of improvements or dynamics in games, but not in matrix games, but rather on games played on graphs. So this is where it's more and more looking like the previous talk. And what we want to do is to be able to prove termination of these dynamics in such games using some kind of formal method theories, like reduction in particular, and we'll see also the notion of minors. And to give you a feeling about what could be the applicability of these techniques, I will start with the application, showing some links with the interdomain routing that is a kind of a natural problem in network theory. So imagine that you are in Europe, this is Poland and this is France, and you want to route a packet towards Texas, towards the United States. Okay. So, of course, there is a very simple way to route such a packet. It's to use the transatlantic connection. But then you have to pay the price of sending a packet very far away. And of course, you could imagine some clever strategy, which is that the French provider could send first the packet to the Poland provider, and then the Poland provider will pay the price of going through the Atlantic. So now you should be able to see that this is some kind of a graph, a game on a graph that I am now playing. It will be clearer in a minute. But we are able to model somehow the preferences of the players with the routes that the packet is following. So for instance, the French provider definitely prefers to send the packet via Poland. So it prefers V1, V2, V-bottom as a path in the graph, rather than the route that is direct V1, V-bottom. And also, there is another route that is very nasty, which is the one that loops forever between France and Poland. Because the Polish guy also wants to send it through France. And so if they just send the packet to each other, this is the very, very nasty situation where the packet doesn't arrive. And there is a similar thing for the other player. So now let's remove the map, and we just with a game on a graph. And here is the situation. So now this is really a game on a graph. It's a very simple graph, but you could imagine that such a situation could happen on more difficult graphs. And there are some problematic stuffs that I will show you now. So first, let me say that in this particular very simple game, there is the biggest problem is that there is not a single Nash equilibrium. So even if you don't know what is Nash equilibrium, it's very easy to see. These two profiles of strategy, so the C1, S2 means that in V1, the player will decide to send the packet through V2, and V2 is willing to pay the price of going through the Atlantic. And the other situation where somehow the play is going through the vertex V1. So now you have two strategies, two profile of strategies, and let's see that this one is Nash equilibrium. Why? Because this player has no incentive to deviate alone, because otherwise he will pay the price of going through the Atlantic, which is worse for him. And this player also has no incentive to deviate, because if he's the only one to deviate from C1, S2, then the play will become C1, C2, which is worse for him. So this is a Nash equilibrium, and there is another one completely symmetric. So this is some kind of the static vision of the game. You study the game and you see, oops, there are two Nash equilibria, okay, which one to choose. So now the dynamic approach will be, let's play for a given number of times, and let's see whether or not we stabilize at some point towards one of those Nash equilibria. So let's say at the beginning you start with the two players that are willing to pay the price of going through Atlantic. Okay. And now, in an asynchronous matter, the two players can decide to change their strategy or not. And let's imagine a situation where, of course, in this situation, both players would prefer to switch. And so it's very natural to think that at the next step somehow, at the next iteration of your algorithm, of your routing algorithm, now you are in a very, very bad situation where the packet does not arrive anymore. It loops forever. And so at some point, at this point, two players want to fix the situation. And because of the asynchronicity, I mean, they cannot communicate synchronously. Because of the asynchronicity, it's also possible that both players decide to switch together and come back to the previous situation. So because of the asynchronous nature of the dynamics, we could block the packets forever or decide to choose a strategy which is not a Nash equilibrium. So you avoid completely the Nash equilibrium. So you are in an undesirable cycle of the dynamics somehow. So let me a little bit formalize that, because what is the question we want to ask is, you start with a game, you obtain some kind of a graph of dynamics, and I will come back to that a little bit later, because we will consider two kinds of dynamics. So you obtain a graph of the dynamics where the vertices now are the profile of strategies of the players, and there is a link if you can switch asynchronously from one to the other. And now the question, in particular in the network community, one of the questions was identify some necessary and sufficient conditions on the game, I mean on the network, directly on the network, such that this particular game graph of the dynamics has no cycles, meaning that no matter how the dynamics evolve, at some point you will reach a stable point. And hopefully this stable point will be exactly one kind of equilibrium, for instance, a Nash equilibrium. So of course, from a network point of view, the conditions should be algorithmically simple, locality stable. I mean, it should not be too evolved. So in particular, you cannot construct the graph of the dynamics and ask your question directly on this graph of the dynamics. And there are some propositions, and I will come back at the end of the talk on those propositions to see how it differs from ours. Okay, so now let me focus on the fact that you could imagine two dynamics very easily. You could imagine two dynamics in those games. So here is the dynamics that we have studied so far, with the asynchronous choice where both players can switch together somehow. And there is also the case where only one single is allowed to switch at each time. I don't know which one, but at each single step, only one player can switch. And so let me just formalize this a little bit, just to be clear about what we are talking about. So first, let me stress out that I will only focus on positional strategies during the talk. And in the paper, there is something more about non-positional strategies. So positional strategies means, again, that you don't care about the history. You don't know where the packet is coming from. You just react when you obtain the packet and you know where it is supposed to go. And so the first simplest dynamics is the one-step dynamics, meaning that only one player is allowed to change during one improvement, during one step of the dynamics. And this player, moreover, is supposed to improve his outcome. So he's supposed to, if he switches, he must switch to something that is better for him. This is quite reasonable. And so this is exactly what you obtain here. So only one single player is changing. So for instance, from C1, C2, which is the worst situation possible, player 2 can decide to switch from C2 to S2, and this is much better for him. And by the way, it's also much better for the other player, but doesn't care. And so here is the complete graph that you obtain, and you see that here you have no cycles. So you have, but you have two stable points, which are exactly the Nash equilibria in the static approach. The asynchronous game that I presented before is what we call the concurrent semantics, the concurrent dynamics, where now several players can decide to change their mind, not all of them, but at least You can have one or, several players that change. They all change at a single node. So you could imagine a game now, a more general game where one player owns several vertices, but still we ask in the dynamics that he makes a change on a single node. And now here is the tricky part. Of course, since you don't know whether or not other players will change, you must just improve your outcome with respect to your single change. So with respect to the current strategy, the current profile of strategy that you know, you must provide a change that is preferable, that is good for you. But maybe when all the synchronous changes are made together, maybe this will be worse for everyone. So it's exactly what happens here, because if you again start from C1, C2, which is the worst situation possible, now both players can switch together and you go there in S1, S2. But because of the previous cycle that we have already seen, even if we are in S1, S2, which is not the best possible choice because it's not a Nash equilibrium, both players could decide to switch because it's preferable for them. But if they do it both together, then it's the worst situation again that you recover. Okay? Okay, so now this asks questions. I mean, just formalizing that with some different dynamics over games on graphs asks some new questions. And so the first question is the network question. So if I give you a game, what is the possible condition so that the graph of the dynamics has no cycle, meaning that at some point the iteration will terminate? But you could ask several other questions, like if I give you a single game but two different dynamics, what should be the relationship between those two dynamics so that one is terminating if and only if the other one is also terminating? Okay. And vice versa, you could fix the dynamics once and for all, but now compare two different games. So I give you two games, G1 and G2, one single dynamics, like the concurrent dynamics, for instance, and now could you compare those games in order to be sure that one is terminating if and only if the other one is also terminating? And of course, these are questions that are, I mean, more precise than the first one that we are looking for. Okay, and so in order to give you a feeling of what we have been able to obtain, I will first present the tools that we have been using, which is simulation and minor in games. So simulation, you all know, so it's going to be very quick. And it's on graphs, not on games, right? So it's on the graph of dynamics, not on the games that I use simulations. So a graph of dynamics G is able to simulate a graph of dynamics G prime somehow. If all that you can do with G prime, you can mimic it in G. So very natural, very, as usual, simulation as usual. Whatever you can do in G prime, if you are able to simulate this profile of strategy in G, then you must be able to mimic it in G. Okay, now there is some kind of a folklore result that I can use here, is that, of course, if the graph of dynamics in G1 simulates a graph of dynamics on G2, then, of course, if the dynamics terminates on the simulator, then it is not possible that you have an infinite path in G2, otherwise it would also mean you have an infinite path in G1, meaning that also the dynamics terminates on G2. So this simulation is able to help you proving termination, okay? And vice versa, it's also proving non-termination. So if the smallest graph is non-terminating, then the biggest one was also not non-terminating. So it's two tools, one for proving termination and the other one for proving non-termination. Okay, so it's kind of folklore. So the one that is not folklore is the next one, which is using the classical notion of minors in graphs, but not on games. So here we have to be a little bit careful. It's a little bit more difficult than just minors in graphs. So still, we say that a game G prime is a minor of another game G if G prime can be obtained from G by a succession of operations, which feels like a minor in graphs. So one is the deletion of an edge. So you can choose an edge and delete it. Okay, easy. If a node becomes isolated, so there is no edge that is touching him, then you can remove it safely. Now the problem is how you remove a node if it is not isolated at some point, and you can do it in a particular case, and let me show it on the example, it's easier. So if you start with this game, I don't tell you what are the players' preferences and so on, but it's just an example. So you can remove edges, okay? So you can decide to remove this edge. Now in this particular game, there is no isolated node, but still I'm able to remove the node V4 somehow. And look at what is happening, by the way. When I remove V4, I make the shortcuts, okay? So in the minor, I obtain all the shortcuts. So if I have an edge from V2 to V4, I have also an edge now in from V2 to V5. Okay, so I put all the shortcuts. And now exactly the condition that I will put is to be sure that this shortcut was not already present in the game before. Because otherwise, with respect to the preferences of the players, I could be unable to retaliate from those conflicting preferences. So it's exactly the fact that there is a single outgoing edge from this node and no shortcuts from all its predecessors. Okay. So kind of technical obligation you have to fulfill in order to be able to delete a node. And you can continue, then you can continue deleting edges and nodes that are either isolated or that fulfill this this condition. Okay. So now the theorem is what? It's relating somehow this minor operation with the simulation operation, and then we just apply the folklore theorem on simulation, which is that if you have a game G prime that is a minor of G, then everything that G can do with respect to the positional one-step dynamics, everything that G prime is going to be able to do, G can mimic it. So G simulates G prime with respect to the positional one-step dynamics, and then you use the folklore theorem, and boom, you obtain that if it terminates for G, if the positional one-step dynamics terminates for G, then it also terminates for G prime. And the same results with some kind of different proof techniques, but the same results also apply for the positional concurrent dynamics. Okay, so it's a relationship between a condition on games, minors, with respect to simulation techniques that you are able to use in order to prove termination in various dynamics, with various dynamics.
Sorry, what is PC positional?
So it's positional concurrent. So it's the one with where all players can switch together, and P1 is positional, one step where a single player is able to change. Okay, now it could be the end, but it's not completely the end because it does not at all match with what network people have been doing. Because somehow the conditions that I have been using in my game theoretic model somehow is not really realistic. So first, it's kind of easy to understand that in network theory, you would like to be able to impose fairness. So in the dynamics, it's not safe if one server, one provider wants to switch, but never is able to do it. So somehow this is possible in my graph of dynamics. I can follow an infinite path where one of the providers is never able to change his own strategy. But this is not realistic from a network point of view. And so you would be able to, instead of speaking about termination, speak about fair termination, where this cannot happen. Another second condition that is not really realistic, maybe, I don't really like that, but I suppose network guys have good reasons to do that, is not to consider any possible switch of strategy for the players, but if they switch switch to their best reply. So if they switch in a given node, in a given router, then they switch to the best possible reply to the current situation. So this changes the dynamics. And you could imagine that still you have the best reply with one single step, with only one player changing, and the best reply with the concurrent. So now you have not only two dynamics, but you have four because of the best replies variance. Okay, so now the landscape is a little bit more blur, maybe. And the problem is that our theorem does not apply, so it's not completely trivial, because it does not apply to fair termination, and it does not apply to the restriction to best reply. This is not okay. The notion of minor is not strong enough in order to capture that. So what we have been doing in the paper is to find some other notion of minors, which is as easy as dealing with the classical notion of minor, which is you can only remove edges if they are dominated by some other edges. And if you stick to that, then it's very good. I mean, the result that you are able to obtain is very good, because now you prove not only that result, that the dynamics terminates for G if and only if it terminates for G prime, but also what you are able to, so it should be fairly terminated, but moreover, it's for the best reply dynamics. Okay, so just before concluding, what I want to show you is that there is now in the network, if I just put the results of the network theory into this setting, here is what they are able to obtain. They have a sufficient condition for termination, which is that they have a necessary condition first. If the best reply concurrent dynamics partially fairly terminates, then necessarily you have only one stable point in your dynamics. So it's not possible that you have two Nash equilibria in your game. They also have a sufficient condition, that is that if you remove some kind of patterns, so imagine that you do not want to have a special game, subgame as a minor, then they are able to prove that indeed the concurrent best reply dynamics fairly terminates. But they do not have a matching condition. So this is exactly what they are looking for. Unfortunately, I'm not able to solve that, but we were able to solve this problem for the non-best reply dynamics. So we are able to find a kind of a stronger pattern that is a necessary and sufficient condition in order to get termination of the positional concurrent dynamics. And at the end of the day, it really just means that you have to be able to check that your game does not contain this nasty game, which is non-terminating because you have two Nash equilibria. And so it's really just checking whether or not you have this game as a minor or not. If you have it, you are not terminating. If you don't have it, you are terminating. Okay, so to summarize, it's a first article in order to study the dynamics in graph games, and so in order to look for equilibria, some kind of equilibria like Nash equilibria. We have studied different possible dynamics. I've gave you four dynamics. And we study some conditions in order to prove termination or fair termination by using, so the tools that we are using is some kind of game minor, some pattern inside the game, and graph simulations. As perspective, so okay, there is the open problem that I told you about in the network theory, finding a necessary and sufficient condition, matching condition on some kind of forbidden minor in the games in order to prove fair termination of the best reply concurrent dynamics. And from our perspective, from the perspective of game theory on games, maybe one interesting thing could be to model some malicious router that maybe is able to cheat a little bit. And this could be modeled with games with imperfect information. So again, what happens with dynamics on such games? We have modeled asynchronicity with the concurrence in the dynamics, but this is not a really realistic model. So maybe we could think about other kind of models. And again, for the fairness, we use the same fairness as for LTL, for instance. But we could also look for probabilistic way of modeling fairness, and this could be another possible perspective. Thank you. No. I mean, so not for the fairness. Fairness would be rather than you want to converge with probability one, so it's rather in the dynamics that you obtain probabilities, but not necessarily in the original game. But of course, you could also consider probabilistic arenas, and I don't know exactly what is the question now, but definitely something to look at.
So, since you were talking about dynamics in this game, like changing the strategy, so does it make sense to think about sub-game perfect equilibrium in this kind of setting?
So, sorry, sub-game perfect equilibria. So, yeah, so we, this is something that we have tried to do, I mean, to catch exactly what is the kind of equilibria that we recover. And in this, this is the case, at least for the positional strategies. So if you are asking whether you are a sub-game perfect equilibrium with respect to just the positional strategies, I don't know if it really makes sense, but then I suppose that the concurrent dynamics is really catching that, the sub-game perfect equilibrium. Like the one-player strategy, one-step dynamics is exactly catching the Nash equilibrium. So there is the relationship. This is why we study, I mean, this is the relationship with concurrence.
So it's really similar to first question, but so something else you can imagine is like players moving kind of continuously on the space of probability distributions of strategy.
Yeah.
You know sort of how that plays and how that plays with the screen.
Yeah, yeah. So now it's more and more like evolutionary game theory. So this is the main ideas. This is where the main idea come from. And then since we are a bit afraid of continuous dynamics, we were trying to study what happens in a discrete time, but definitely now that we have done that, maybe it's worth coming back to the realm maybe of probabilistic arenas where you add probabilities also in the arena, and now you need probabilities in your strategies, and maybe a continuous evolution is worth studying, yes, definitely.
Thank you.